The Reach Surgical 3rd Generation Endoscopic Linear Cutter Endo 3. Introduction to Endo 3 and each of its parts. Anvil. Cartridge holder. Flexible neck. Shaft. Function knob. Rotation articulation indicator. White trigger. Closing lever. Return knob. 6 different height cartridges. Applications of the Endo 3. Endo 3 endoscopic linear cutter couple with a single-use cartridge works for open or endoscopic surgery, for dissection, transection, and anastomosis of lung, bronchial, stomach, and intestinal tissues. Endo 3 can be used with up to 12 cartridges in a single surgery. Endo 3 features and benefits. The cartridge has a single-use knife. Single-use knife is better to avoid tumor metastasis. 400 series knife is sharper and more effective. 6 different height cartridges can handle different tissue thicknesses. All can pass through a 12 millimeter trocar, so it is even less invasive. Increased tissue compression at the jaw. Tissue compression is 3 times more compared to the previous instrument. There is much less tissue milking and better staple formation. Flexible neck. The jaw can be stopped at any angle between 0 and 45 degrees. Can better handle difficult angles during surgery. Stable control. Force to fire is 25% less compared to other similar devices. Stable firing. Less shaking, more effective. Reduces risk of damage to tissue from pulling. Single function knob with rotation and articulation. Easier for one-handed operation.
Welcome everyone. Good morning. Selamat pagi. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam sejahtera bagi kita semua. Om Swastiastu. Namo Buddhaya. Salam kebajikan. Thank you for joining us today's webinar. I'm Cepi Mariadi, Head of Commercial Department of PT Advanced Medical Corpora, and I will be hosting today's session. Our company initiate and support this webinar as a part of our educational program. Today we have a very special guest, Dr. Reno Rudiman, to talk about appendectomy from open to minimal invasive surgery tips and tricks. As we have some attendees from outside Indonesia, Dr. Rudiman will give a lecture in English, whilst I myself as a host will continue in Bahasa or maybe mix with English. As you know, Dr. Rudiman is an Instagram famous surgeon who has about 35,000 followers. You can easily find him in the account at Rudiman Surgery and give it a follow if you would like to. We proud and honor share his passion in lecturing. So before we go, just a little housekeeping before we get started. This is a webinar rules that mention that your audio will be muted, and you are also can be recognized as an attentive attendee or not. So please do not minimize the windows if you would like to be recognized as attentive attendee. And also, if you have a question, there is a panel on the right side of the session. You can write down and submit to us, and we will do it for the next Q&A session. So before we continue, we just want to share about the company. We are PT Advanced Medical Corpora is an exclusive distributor for Calstors, a global brand for endoscopy or minimally invasive surgery. We also has a license to market the Reed Surgical product, the company who has a headquarter in USA. So just give us 2 minutes to introduce our product. Now I'm turning to Bahasa Indonesia. So firstly, we have a product for prolapse or prolapse and hemorrhoid. This product is has a punya karakteristik yang bagus, yang baik untuk dokter pergunakan, yaitu mempunyai anvil yang ramping sehubungan dengan sehingga dia dapat minimalkan kerusakan jaringan. Kemudian dia mempunyai diameter yang lebih besar, membantu mengurangi stenosis post operasi. Kemudian juga kami mempunyai Reed linear cutter untuk dari produk Reed Surgical untuk open surgery yang untuk prosedur resection, transection ataupun anastomosis pada open ataupun minimal invasif surgery. Dapat juga karena ini ada pisau yang cukup tajam untuk pemotongan yang memastikan pemotongan yang lebih bersih. Kemudian dapat melakukan firing dari kedua sisi, menawarkan fleksibilitas dan kemudahan penggunaan. Kami khusus untuk para attendee webinar ini, kami menyediakan special offer, yaitu 50% untuk harga perkenalan untuk dua produk tersebut. Silakan untuk mengisinya pada form feedback setelah acara ini. Produk berikutnya dari kami adalah produk Calstors. Produk Calstors ini sudah sangat terkenal bagi dokter-dokter ahli bedah minimal invasif ya. di antaranya ini kami ingin memperlihatkan produk imaging terbaru ya dari Kalsos, yaitu Image 1S. Image 1S ini dapat digunakan dokter untuk berbagai prosedur dengan representasi seperti misalnya dalam dua dimensi endoskopi, dokter bisa menggunakan baik 3chip full HD maupun standar definition, juga dapat digunakan untuk digabungkan dengan mikroskop. Kami juga mempunyai kamera, head kamera yang mampu memberikan resolusi 4K, sebuah terobosan yang terbaru. Juga untuk endoskopi 3D, kami punya teleskop yang khusus 3D, serta untuk teleskop eksoskop penggunaan prosedur open. 3D ini sangat menarik, nanti saya akan sampaikan berikutnya. Juga kamera sistem kami dapat memberikan prosedur bersamaan dengan fleksibel, misalnya dalam eksplorasi CBD, dapat dilakukan PIP dengan memberikan bersamaan dengan fleksibel. Selanjutnya, kami juga mempunyai teknologi terbaru dari sisi imaging, yaitu Image 1S Rubina. Ini adalah kamera sistem tercanggih yang menggabungkan berbagai teknologi tercanggih juga, yaitu dengan resolusi 4K, dia juga bisa 3D, dan yang menarik adalah 3D-nya, teleskopnya dapat secara otomatis merespon, mengontrol horizon, sehingga orientasi tidak akan hilang. Teknologi ini juga dilengkapi dengan teknologi imaging fluorescence, menggunakan near infrared dan menggunakan zat pewarna indocyanine green. Nah, untuk yang terakhir ini, saya sampaikan bahwa teknologi near infrared ini atau fluorescence ini secara umum punya teknologi opal yang dapat memberikan tampilan, membuat tampilan demarkasi antar jaringan yang kaya dengan fluorescence ataupun tidak, atau ada fluoresensinya atau tidak, sehingga dapat membantu dokter dalam bernavigasi dalam melakukan operasi, yaitu berupa tampilan monokromat, berupa abu-abu, warna abu-abu dan kegelapan, kemudian intensity map, dan juga overlay, pilihannya bisa blue atau green. Demikian produk yang ingin kami sampaikan pada saat webinar ini, mudah-mudahan terima kasih untuk kesabarannya. Nah, saatnya sekarang saya akan memperkenalkan pembicara kita, yaitu Dr. Reno Rudiman, seorang ahli bedah dari Rumah Sakit Hasan Sadikin, Bandung. Beliau mempunyai master degree di University of Aberdeen, UK, kemudian bergelar doktor dari Universitas Pajajaran. Dr. Rudiman ini punya special interest di minimal invasive surgery dan juga robotic surgery ya. Beliau adalah yang pertama melakukan tindakan transvaginal cholecystectomy di Indonesia pada tahun 2008. Beliau juga sibuk mengajar secara level nasional ataupun internasional, dan beliau sekarang memangku jabatan sebagai President of Indonesian Metabolic and Bariatric Society. Baik, saya serahkan sesi berikutnya kepada Dr. Rudiman untuk ambil stage. Silakan, Dok.
Baik, thank you very much, Pak Cepi, for the sincere introduction, and it's a very nice privilege for me to speak before all of you in this webinar on Saturday morning in Indonesian time. So allow me to convey my presentation in English, because we have also to respect all attendees here from all over the world. And before I begin, I would like to have also I would like to know all of you. So could you please, Pak Cepi, help me on showing the profile or do some little poll of the attendees here now?
Okay, Doc. Okay. This is the our poll, Doc.
Yes.
So you can lead the poll, Doc, please.
Yes. How to how to okay. lead the poll?
Let me do it.
Do
for you
have that okay. question?
Yeah. We have question here. Please yes. submit your question for this question. The first question. The first question is how many of
yes.
you select one of the following?
Yes. Yes. Where can I see the questions?
Dia enggak.
I cannot see the questions.
Okay, we will restart that. Okay, we will restart that. Okay. Oh, the fact that they have already the attendee already fill in, Doc. Have you seen the
yes.
the result for the how many of you as a practicing surgeon? There is 39%. Surgical resident 20%. Qualified doctors, non-surgeon 19%. Medical intern 4% and student medical student. I mean, it is 17%.
Yes. Okay.
So
thank you.
That's the next yeah. question will be
so I can see the presentation.
Okay, I just read it for you. Maybe we have a little technical problem here. For surgeon only, this is for surgeon only. How many open appendectomy yes. surgeries do you perform monthly? The question mm-hmm. is the answer is 10 to 20 procedure monthly. 1 to 9 or none. We give it a poll to the audience for 30 seconds from now. Please fill in. Okay. We have the result, Doc. If you cannot see the screen, the result is 10 to 20 procedure, about 31%, less than 10 procedures a month, almost half, 49%, and 9, 21%. That's the second
okay.
polling, Doc. The third
okay.
polling. The third polling will be like this. For surgeon only, how many laparoscopic appendectomy surgeries do you perform monthly? The option for the answer is 10 to 20 procedures, 1 to 9 procedures, and 9. Please fill the answer. And we give it the time about 30 seconds from now. The result is will be like this, Doc. So for laparoscopic, we have 3% doing a laparoscopic appendectomy for almost 10 to 20 procedure a month. Less than 10, we have 26%. The rest is never done with the laparoscopic. So about 70% the audience never done a laparoscopic appendectomy. I think that's the attendee population, Doc, from the polling.
Okay, thank you very much, JP. So I kind of guide the overview of you audience. So I'll try to do my best to present my slides and in order that you can all understand of what is the content. So let me share my screen. Can you give the screen privilege to me, Pachepi?
It's already, Doc. We can see your slide.
Oh, you can see me. You can see my slide. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so good morning to all my friends in Indonesia, and also good very early morning in India, and it's just almost after midnight in Europe, and in America it's in the afternoon or evening. Anyway, it is now my turn to give the presentation about appendicitis or appendectomy. But before we go into the topic of appendectomy, it is essential to know what is actually the disease. So this is just a gift to overview of what is appendicitis. Probably this will be useful for those of you who are still in the medical schools. Appendicitis is defined as an inflammation of the inner lining of the vermiform appendix that spread to its other parts. So if we can see that appendix is just in the edge of the sacrum, it will be obstructed and then causing appendicitis. So despite diagnostic and therapeutic advancement in medicine, still, appendicitis is a clinical emergency. It requires surgical procedure to overcome the disease. How about the signs and symptoms of appendicitis? Well, as we all know from all textbooks, that the classic history of pain, right lower abdominal pain, unfortunately, it only occurs in only 50% of cases. Most of the acute appendicitis patient presentation are they present as abdominal pain, but not specific. They may have nausea, they may have anorexia, vomiting maybe once a while, maybe diarrhea and constipation, but it is inconsistent usually the clinical signs. However, regarding the abdominal pain, it typically begins at periumbilical or epigastric, and then it migrates to the right lower abdomen. Usually the patient lie down, they flex their hips, draw their knees in order to reduce the pain, because every movement or every coughing or sneezing or walking, it initiate or provoke the pain. And usually it happens only less than 48 hours, making it patient come to the hospital. And sometimes in some specific group of people like elderly patient, they are prone to perforation. Of course, with perforation, then comes the clinical worsening. So in physical examination, we can feel a rebound tenderness, pain on percussion, rigidity, and guarding. And right lower quadrant, when the disease progress in 24 to 48 hours, it becomes tenderness become obvious. And sometimes we can examine that in from the left lower quadrant tenderness. If we put pressure on the left abdomen, it may pain may provoke the right lower abdomen. And in infant or in children, sometimes the pain and we can see inflammation spread into the hemiscrotum. And we must also be careful when facing acute appendicitis patients in pregnant women, because the point of maximum tenderness is used sometimes go upward because of the uterus positioning, then the appendix may go to the right flank, going up, filling up. There are some accessory signs that you can examine, like Rofsing sign, obturator sign, psoas sign, etc., etc. I will not go into detail on this. You can check that the sometimes it's not necessary to check them all. It's just to confirm that if we are in case of doubt, then this accessory sign may be useful, but it's not always positive on every patient. Now, how to diagnose? Actually, 80% of clinical diagnosis can be solved by good history taking and physical examinations. However, diagnosis laboratory examination may be useful. We can check the complete blood count, the C-reactive protein, and etc., etc. And in women with reproductive age, maybe it is wise to check whether she is pregnant or not, because ectopic pregnancy may also can feel or can show the clinical condition mimicking acute appendicitis. The complete blood count, usually there is increase of white blood cell in 80 to 85% of adults with appendicitis. Because it's an acute infection, neutrophilia may predominate. However, in infant or in elderly, white blood cell usually unreliable. So there is no specific blood count that can direct us it is an acute appendicitis. You have to combine all the data, including the history taking, physical examination, and the lab, and then you can conclude that it is suggestive of acute appendicitis. However, in checking the C-reactive protein, if it is usually increased in appendicitis, the very high level of CRP, it indicates probably the appendix has gone gangrenous. So it shows the severity of the disease. CT scan sometimes is useful in doubtful clinical condition. We can see the appendix is larger, like here from coming out from the sacrum, the appendix is larger than usual, and it usually close to the psoas muscle. And ultrasound is useful. We can see like this the target sign. Target sign like this. And this is in sagittal, you can see a tubular like appearance. Sorry. Now this is the tubular section. You can see the shadow of the appendix. However, it is important to know that not always acute appendicitis shows suggestive ultrasound, because sometimes in acute condition with paralytic alleles, with many bowel air, it can hide the appendix from ultrasound imaging. So when you find appendix shadow like this, it is suggestive appendicitis. But when you don't find it, it is not always not appendicitis, because sometimes it's false negative. Well, when the facility available, sometimes they perform radionuclide light scanning, and you can see a focal uptake of in the right lower quadrant of the abdomen. But this is actually it's too much for acute appendicitis. It's just maybe shove in very special cases. We seldom do it. It's not a routine examination. When patient come in septic condition with very painful abdominal condition, you sometimes the appendix perforate and can you see intraperitoneal air below diaphragm. So this is suggestive of perforated appendicitis. In barium contrast enema, when you perform barium contrast enema, normally the contrast can fill the appendix like this. But in usually we perform contrast study in chronic condition. In chronic condition, we can perform, but in acute, it is not recommended. In chronic condition, when the contrast doesn't fill the appendix, so a diminishing appendix shadow, it is suggestive that the appendix is obstructed and may go for surgery. Okay, now let's go to the management. The emergency management of the patient, usually we establish intravenous access, crystalloid therapy infusion, and usually we give nothing patient per oral. And it is wise to give the patient parenteral analgesic and antiemetic to make the patient comfortable before the surgery. Now, the main topic of this presentation is the appendectomy. Well, appendectomy remains the only curative treatment for appendicitis. Sometimes when the patient come late to the hospital or to the doctor, may show as appendiceal mass. So in appendiceal mass, sometimes there is a place to put the patient into IV antibiotic therapy first, and then let the mass reduce, and then we can perform appendectomy later on. But there are also studies that suggest us to perform acute surgery even in the appendiceal mass. This is a subject to controversy. What about non-surgical treatment? Well, apparently our current condition with COVID-19 global pandemics, there at the beginning of the pandemic, there is also a suggestion from international institutions and organization for not to perform appendectomy or cholecystectomy or any simple surgery, because we still didn't know how the coronavirus spread from patient to patient, from patient to doctor, or from doctor to patient. So there was once at the beginning of the global pandemic, it is suggested do not perform surgery for appendicitis. Then what do we do? We give IV antibiotics. And well, it is also applicable for those patients who doesn't have any access to any surgical facilities, such as of the submarine crew out in the ocean, and then to go to closest hospital takes some times, maybe days or weeks. So it is wise to give them IV antibiotics. However, from studies, it is proven that so for those patients who got non-surgical treatment, usually the appendicitis recurrent within 14 months. So we can conclude that appendectomy is still the best choice for the acute appendicitis patients. What about preoperative antibiotics? It is usually depends on the bacterial profile. Profile for the cecal or appendix, they are usually gram-negative and anaerobe. So we have to choose a proper or appropriate antibiotics for gram-negative and anaerobic bacteria, which is usually a cephalosporin is enough, or beta-lactamase antibiotic, and carbapenem is also a good choice. However, be careful in pregnant patients. You have to choose antibiotic that is safe for the pregnancy. Now, how urgent or how emergent is the appendectomy performed? What is the best timing to perform appendectomy? And this is a study from American College of Surgeons, National Surgical Quality Improvement Project. They compare appendectomy, which is performed within 24 hours, compared to within 48 hours. They find that the result has similar outcome. So whether you perform it within 24 hours or on the next day, it is still safe. However, a delay of operative intervention longer than 48 hours, it doubles the complication rate. So the best timing is within 48 hours. So if you face acute appendicitis, probably in the night, it is safe to postpone the surgery until the next morning where you are fresh and the OR team is ready. It is still safe. However, do not delay until more than 48 hours. That's the best timing. Okay, what about laparoscopy versus open? Well, there are many studies that confirm the benefit of laparoscopic appendectomy because it has decreased postoperative pain. It gives the patient better aesthetic result because the wound is very small and the patient has shorter time return to usual activities. And also it has lower incidence of wound infection or dehiscence. But I will share this issue later on about the wound infection. Okay, this is just one meta-analysis study, which is very good, written in 2017, that shows the benefit of laparoscopic surgery compared to open appendectomy in adults and in children. In adults, it is confirmed laparoscopic is better. However, in children, it is better, but it didn't reveal significant difference. Probably the case is just too small, or I don't know, maybe there are some reason where children doesn't have show such benefit like in adult. Okay, now the issue of open appendectomy. There are various incisions in performing open appendectomy. For those of you who are already familiar with appendectomy procedure, we can see that there are many incision. The most popular one was McBurney incision, and then there are also Lance incision, Rutherford Mauritius extension, or Fowler waist to the medial extension. It depends on the surgical or the surgeon's preference. However, what is my favorite? My favorite is this is Lance incision. Longer incision, because the longer incision, it is usually we can reach the sacrum and then we can go to the appendix by guiding of the tenia coming out from the sacrum. It is easy to do that. We will elaborate this later. The step, we do incision, and then skin, subcutaneous tissue, and then dissection through both superficial and deep fascia, and we open external oblique aponeurosis and incision in direction of fiber. The way I do it, I always make incision as small as possible to because we don't want to for patient to have such large incision in because for aesthetic result, also for post-operative pain, it is better to give only a small incision. After the superficial oblique and then the external oblique, and then it we split the muscle bluntly. We can use Kelly clamp or rule retractors. I usually use rule retractors like this, or Langenbeck retractor. And it is important the role of the assistant in providing access, because we don't want to give incisions as large as such this picture, So it is more also always more difficult when the patient is relatively obese, but however, with proper retraction, it is possible to gain access beautifully. After the muscle splitting, we go on deeper into the fascia of both internal oblique muscle and transversus abdominis to expose transversus fascia and peritoneum. So maybe we need more retractors, but sometimes in a very small wound, the retractors can fight into each other. So it is important the role of assistant in opening the access so we can get easy access to the inner abdomen and the intraperitoneal. Then we grab the peritoneum with two straight clamps and palpation between surgeon fingers. We can see the surface is very usually it's whitish, and be careful not to grab the bowel behind the peritoneum. So you have to take it a very little bite, so you don't grasp the bowel behind. And then after opening the peritoneum, we can find the appendix. Sometimes it's not easy to find the appendix. Sometimes the appendix are located behind the sacrum or behind the small bowel. So we need to familiarize ourselves with the anatomy. We need good retraction. Sometimes the positioning of the patient and the OR table, it is useful. Make it trendelenburg. The patient head is down, and then we can get easier access to the pericecal region. And then sometimes the patient is tilted and to the right, to the left. So the sacrum is more upward. And then when give aside the small bowel, you can use gauze. You can use gauze. However, be careful the gauze. Do not plunge it without fixation. So we don't want to lose the gauze inside. It is very difficult to get it back if the wound is small. So then after we give away the small bowel, we can identify the large bowel. And then the large bowel, we grasp it, we find the tinea. The meeting of the three tineas from the colon is usually the base of the appendix. Then we can go this appendix out, and then we can dissect the mesoappendix like this. We can dissect the mesoappendix, and we can use either energy device such as harmonic scalpel or ligature. We can usually made by suture with thick rail 2x3O. It's good. Then be careful. Also, one tip from me that always try not to let appendix in contact with the wound, because appendix is in acute condition is dirty, especially when it's gangrenous. It's very infectious. There are many large bowel bacteria in, and when the appendix is in contact with the wound, it will give a wound infection later on. So whenever possible, always try to make some distance between appendix and the wound. It's not easy when the wound is small, but when you are focused in doing so, you can cover the appendix with a gauze. Yeah, so always protect the wound clean. That's tips from me. Always protect the wound so it will not give wound infection later on. You can see the video here. I'm sorry, it's not my own video, because I rarely now, actually rarely perform open appendectomy now. It is usually done by general surgeons. However, this video is very good in showing us how to do the open appendectomy safely and beautifully. See, the incision is only the, I think it's only 2 cm, and 2 cm, and then a subcutaneous is dissected with Bovi. Identify the muscles by the muscles fibers. Yeah, at this point, the importance of placing the retractor is very important. Sometimes you need more than one retractor to expose the tissue, the muscles. Yeah, you see, you use Metzenbaum scissors to split. The muscle splitting can be done bluntly if you can identify the muscle fibers. It is good to split the muscles. See, and then if you can identify the fibers, you can split the muscle so you don't have to cut them all. With sharp dissection, it's not always necessary. With placing the retractor like this, so when you enter subcutaneous tissue and then fascia and then external oblique, transverse oblique, internal oblique, and then you will find the peritoneum. The whitish surface is the peritoneum, and then after you enter, you see, you can grasp the large bowel, identify the tania. Usually the edge of the tania is where the base of appendix is located. Sometimes you can feel the hardness or the consistency of appendix by inserting your finger. But if possible, do not do it because it will spread the infection, the local infection, by inserting our finger. But sometimes it's necessary when you face difficulties. So at the edge of the tania is the base of the appendix where it's located. And then be careful taking it out. As for me, I always try my best to avoid appendix in contact with the skin wound. Be careful, the appendix is very fragile in this condition. So do not give so much power when you extracting. See, this is the appendix is very very large. I think this is a very acute condition. And then you can dissect the mesial appendix. By this, you are ligating the appendicular artery, like this, the artery. So you have, if you have energy device like harmonic scalpel or rigasure, they can coagulate the artery safely and quick. However, if not, it is always better by putting a safe knotting suture, surgical knot, to stop or to ligate the appendiceal artery. Yes, you can do the suture or just by noting. As you can see on this video, you can only do noting. Okay. So that's about appendectomy. How about the how about the closure of the wound? You see, these are my tips that I already mentioned when I explaining the video. The table of positioning, usually in translabral position, where the head is lower than the extremities, and smallest incision possible, as for me, to give minimal post-op pain and better cosmetic result, and grasp the right colon, trace the tenia leading to appendix, and minimum contact of appendix lumen to the abdominal wall. This is to decrease the chance of the wound infection later on. Now, what about the main wound closure? I haven't mentioned this. Wound closure, you suture the muscle, the fascia, the subcutaneous tissue, skin, but I don't suture the peritoneum. Usually, I leave the peritoneum, leave it open. It is safe, and it is faster not to suture the peritoneum. And actually, there are some scientific evidence to support my tips. Like this, an article from 2018, the frequency of wound infection after appendectomy. Oh, sorry, this is actually explaining other things. The wound infection. So the wound infection can happen like this, where you can see this is usually happening. Why? Usually happening when the dirty appendix came in contact with the wound. When the appendix in contact with the wound, the appendix is full of bacteria and give the later on wound infection. So this is why I always try my best to avoid appendix come in contact with the abdomen. And what then will you do when the appendix it came in contact? You clean it before you close the wound. You clean it vigorously, as clean as possible before suturing. This avoid the infection later on. Also, remember to give preoperative antibiotic. Also, the main as prophylaxis, it's also important. And of course, there's some anecdotal picture that I usually laugh when I see this. So this is just a joke. Then you get infection just because the suture is not properly done. Okay. Okay, let's come back to the topic of why I don't suture the peritoneum. This is scientific evidence to show that non-closure of the peritoneum during appendectomy, it gives the advantage of it's causing less post-operative pain. See, and the time is, you save time by not doing the peritoneum closure. So when after you remove the appendix, usually you irrigate the periscopal area, you cleanse the periscopal area, and then after that, you directly close the muscle, and then the fascia, subcutaneous, and then the skin. So by skipping suturing the peritoneum, it saves time, and it also less post-operative pain. Okay, now let's go to the laparoscopic appendectomy. Actually, laparoscopic appendectomy is now gaining popularity. And as I know, some of you already perform laparoscopic appendectomy here. So probably what I want to do is just share on how do I do laparoscopic appendectomy according to my method, which may be slightly different from what you do, but of course some principles are always in practice. This is just a sample of a checklist for the laparoscopic appendectomy. I'm sorry, the text is already is too they are too small, but mainly what I want to show you is the it is always safe to have a checklist so you don't skip any important things when you doing the surgery. Okay, trocar position. Well, these are three examples of trocar positions I got from the literatures. Some puts the camera view and the umbilicus, and then the two trocars slightly suprapubic, and then on the from the left flank to gain access to the pericycal area. Others perform like this: one in umbilicus, one in suprapubic, but one the other one is from the right flank. Usually, I don't like this position because actually it is easier if you perform the appendectomy with assistant. So the assistant can hold the retractor from the right flank. Like this, this is far left and then far right, and then the umbilical serve as the camera port. Also, I don't like actually. What I do best, I don't have the picture, but my favorite thing is that the camera port is here, one in the suprapubic, but the other one is the in here upper. Why do I do that like that? Because let's imagine if the camera enters from here, then your both instrument coming from the left of the view of the monitor. So it is not not an ideal condition when instrument coming from all the same sides. But what I do best, what I like best, is to put the camera port in the umbilicus, one in here and one in here up here. Therefore, what I got is the camera is through from the middle, and then the right instrument coming from the right, the left instrument coming from the right, from the left. So it is where it gives me the best maneuverability. Okay, about the positioning. Trendelenburg is the positioning, and the patient tilt to the left. By that, you gain access to the pericycal area where there's all the small bowels falls to the other side. Well, my position is all trocars in the midline, as I explained before. Of course, beware of trocar related injury. You have to always put trocar under vision, and then meticulously visualize all the entire abdominal cavity. This is one advantage of laparoscopic appendectomy compared to open surgery, because in open surgery you do only small incision and then you go directly to the appendix. Sometimes when the patient is false positive, suspicion of appendix, and then when we incise, actually then we found out that the appendix is normal, probably there are some other diseases, probably ovarian cyst or anything, or mesenteritis and everything. We cannot do much about from the small incision, but in laparoscopy you can visualize all entire abdominal cavity. You can see, and in the female you can see the reproductive organs, the ovary, the uterus, and also in males you want to see how the gallbladder and everything. So that is one of the advantages of laparoscopy compared to open surgery. Okay, the trocar incision. Beware of trocar related injury. So always under direct vision. As we can see from here, after the incision of the camera port, the other trocar, we insert the trocar under direct vision. Also, I forgot to mention, it is wise if for appendectomy, we don't insert catheter because the procedure is simple, usually less than 1 hour. So to reduce the chance of urinary tract infection postoperatively, I don't insert a Foley catheter to the urinary bladder. Then it is wise to instruct the patient to empty the bladder before the induction of anesthesia. So we got the perisacral area with empty urinary bladder. It is better, and it avoid the chance of trochal related injury when the trochar is inserted above the suprapubis. Okay, next. After all the instruments are inside, we identify the perisacral anatomy. So the perisacral anatomy, we can see here, sometimes the patient have some adhesion. We have to be careful, make the small bowel away from your view, and always in every laparoscopic surgery, always make it easier to view our instrument. Always try to see all the instrument under your vision. And see, we can grasp the appendix here. Be careful dissecting all the adhesion. Identify clearly where is the base of the appendix, where is the cecum, where is the small bowel. So be careful of the energy device like this, because it is hot. After you fire, the energy device is becoming a hot instrument. So be careful, do not try to get away the small bowel by using the hot instrument like this. It gives the thermal injury later on. So serve the energy device as only the mean of energy device, not as a traction device. For the traction device, you use other instrument because you know it's cold. It doesn't give the risk of a thermal injury later on. Now the mesoappendix dissection. Identify clearly where is the mesoappendix. So if you have the privilege of using the energy device, it is really practical and handy to cut the mesoappendix. Be careful, identify the anatomy very clearly. Injury to the cecum or to the cecum is intolerable. It may give a delayed perforation of the cecum later on. You don't want to face that. So be careful. You skeletonize the appendix. Until it's very clear. Skeletonization in this step is very important. Not only to control the appendiceal artery, to stop the appendiceal artery, but also skeletonizing all the fatty tissue of the mesoappendix is useful when you extract the appendix through the trochar. When the appendix is fat, with full of fat, it is very difficult to get it out from the 10 millimeter trochar. So skeletonizing is also useful, making the appendix is really slim to get it out from the trocar later on. Okay, let me remind you again, beware of the heat from the energy device. So, and also important is to maintain traction for optimum dissection. So if you do it alone, so you give the camera port to the camera assistant, and you have access to the both right hand and left hand instrument, then you can know how important is the traction, and you can give more traction and to get optimum dissection. However, if you put or you give the second instrument to the second assistant, it is important for the assistant to give good traction for the surgeon to do the dissection safely. And then, as we can see, some surgeon perform the appendectomy using stapler, and others using endoloop. Now, I will explain it later. Sometimes, if you have the facility, you can use stapling device for the transection of the appendix. Of course, as the case in Indonesia, this is a very expensive device. I don't know if Pak Cepi, do you have this endo stapler? We can discuss it later on the Q&A session. But for most of patients, the more affordable approach is to use endoloop. This is a stapling device. Using endoloop is much cheaper and the similar outcome compared to the stapling device. Of course, it takes longer because usually we need at least 3 endoloop to control the transection. We put 2 in the base and then 1 mid distal, and then we can transect the appendix. So it takes more time than stapling device, but it's much more economical. And then one more important thing is to get the appendix out. If you have the facility, use endobag. Of course, why do we need endobag? Because we want to avoid contact of the appendix to the trocar wound. When the appendix is in contact with the trocar wound, with the incision wound, it is always can give wound infection later on. So it is best, as in open appendectomy, I always avoid or always prevent the contact of the appendix with the abdominal wound. And this is my video on the laparoscopic appendectomy. As we can see, my favorite position is camera in the umbilicus, and then right trocar and left trocar coming from the right and left. So put one in suprapubic, one in epigastrium. Camera coming from the middle. So it is where it gives us nice view and then nice maneuverability. We can grasp the appendix by the left hand, and then we do dissection using the right hand. And the camera in the middle. This is my favorite position. And then I use endoloop to transect the appendix. Yes, this is the first endoloop. And then to strengthen the knotting, I put the second and then the third bit distal, so we can perform the transection safely. This is so you have to measure the distance between the 2 loops here and 1 loop here. So when you transect, you give enough space for the transaction, avoiding the cutting of the envelope. Because if you cut the envelope, and then it is useless. We don't want to give spillage of the appendix lumen. And then we retract the appendix through the trocar. Okay, this is the example, and this is not my patient, but only to give you example how the wound are small. Yes, I'm sorry, I don't have the wound of my patient where I put the trocar, one here, and one here. I think that's all that I can share about the tips and tricks on open appendectomy and laparoscopic appendectomy. I hope this gives you idea on how do I do it. And for those who are already familiar with all these procedures, maybe you can share also your experiment, or you can comment on how do you it. And probably if you do it better than me, and I can learn from you. And for those of you who are interested in doing so, or one or becoming a surgeon, I would be so much happy to give you a special teaching session, probably, if you are interested. Anyway, thank you very much for your kind attention. I hope there will be a lively discussion after this. That's all that I can present. Thank you. Yes, please, Pak Cepi.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rudiman, for the nice presentation. Now we are going to the next session for Q&A. So we will go ahead. We take some time for question now. We have already about seven questions, Dr. Rudiman. Read it for you.
Yes, please.
Okay. The first question coming from Dr. Wildan. Dr. Wildan asking about which one better examination to support the diagnosis between ultrasound and abdominal CT scan in case of appendicitis. That's the first question. I think you can answer directly for this question, and then I will follow with the next question after that.
Okay. Of course, a CT scan is much better. It has a very high sensitivity and very high specificity. It's very accurate in CT scan for appendicitis. However, it is cumbersome and expensive. So it is not always practical to perform CT scan. So the next best thing is the ultrasound. Ultrasound gives you also good sensitivity. However, as I mentioned before, if you find signs of appendicitis from the ultrasound, then it supports your diagnosis. However, if you don't find positive finding from the ultrasound, it doesn't mean that the patient is negative for appendicitis. Sometimes it gives you false negative because the appendix is blocked by the shadow of the small bowel. So ultrasound is good enough, but if you want better accuracy, you perform CT scan. Thank you, Dr. Jeffy.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Rudiman. Thank you also for Dr. Wildan for the question. I hope the answer is satisfied. And then for the next question coming from Dr. Jamie Sutantio. Dr. Jamie asking about what is your view on placing surgical drain after laparoscopic or laparotomy on appendix abscess or perforation? That's the question, Doc.
Sorry, can you repeat? The sound quality was not okay. Good.
Okay, sorry for that. What is your view on placing surgical drain after laparoscopic or laparotomy on this case, on the case of the perforation of or abscess.
Oh, okay. Passing drain. Yes. 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 I don't perform insertion of drain routinely. So it depends on the case. When the patient is already peritonitis and localized peritonitis, and you perform either laparoscopy or open, you may insert drain. But of course, inserting drain, as we can see from scientific evidence, is not always useful. Sometimes it's it gives the risk of the further secondary infection. So it's a case by case scenario. It depends on the case. If you think it's necessary, then go ahead, insert drain. But it's not a routine procedure.
Okay. Thank you, Dok. I hope the answer is good for you, Dr. Jamie. Thank you for the question. The next question coming from Dr. Intan Eklesiana. She's asking about during appendectomy, Doc, what should we do if we were unable to clearly expose the appendix from our small incision due to, for example, adhesion or heavily inflamed, something like that? Can you understand
okay.
the question?
Thank you, Intan. Yeah. Yes. Yes, thank you, Intan, for the question. So here's Dr. Intan. If you face difficulty in gaining proper exposure to the appendix through the small incision, then go ahead enlarge the wound. Enlarge the wound because we perform small incision in order for us to get a good aesthetic result and minimal postoperative pain. But safety is number one. If we struggle very difficult through small incision, then the struggle is not worth if we get complication or get the prolonged operation, the operative time is very prolonged, and the risk of injuring other organ is threatening you, then go ahead and enlarge the wound. So safety is number one. The benefit that we want to gain from good aesthetic result and minimal postoperative pain is simply cannot be traded off from for the sake of the safety of the operative result. So of course we have to explain to the patient later on or to the family why we do a large incision, because the appendix is already massive adhesion and everything. Yeah, with proper and appropriate explanation, usually the patient or the family can understand on why we have we give a wide incision. So I hope it's you're satisfied with the answer, Dr. Intan.
Okay, Doc. We have another question. I think we have so many questions, Doc, here already. We will select one of them. Hopefully, we can have more time for this. There is a question coming from Dr. Randy Christopher. Thank you, Dr. Randy, for the question. He's asking about, he said, a problem I had encountered when I performed laparoscopic appendectomy is perforated appendicitis was the diffuse distended small bowel. It really annoyed me because it blocked my visualization when I want to approach and manipulate the appendix. Do you have any tips or trick to do when I encounter a such situation? Thank you.
Yes. As a surgeon, it depends on your level of expertise. If you are a laparoscopic surgeon who have a long history and deal with many cases, of course you can go on the laparoscopy despite all the difficulties. I will give the tips later on, but if you are not have a long history or a long experience in such difficult case, then it is always safer to convert to open surgery. It is always safer. But from my experience, if I face that, I position the patient more extreme. The Trendelenburg and the tilt of the patient give it more extreme. Of course, remember to strap the patient to the OR table beforehand to avoid the patient falling for the table. And that's the least we want to face for the patient falling from the OR table. To strap the patient and then very extreme position until 30 degrees probably on the extreme Trendelenburg, extreme tilt, and then you put more trocar. Other trocar serves as the retractor for all the small bowel. You can give maybe two more trocar, so you get a total five more trocar to give away all the small bowel. Then however, be careful when all the small bowel are deleted. Incision of trocar is also dangerous if you cannot do it safely under vision. So when you are experienced enough, you can try to struggle to gain access despite the dilatation of the small bowels. But if you're not confident enough to do that, then go ahead convert to open laparotomy if you want to be safer. Okay, Dr. Randy, I hope it answers you.
Thank you, Doc. The next question coming from Dr. Natalia Maria Cristina. Please explain about Trochard port in epigastrium. Doesn't it mean that we have a further space to dissect the appendix?
Yes. Usually, don't put it too high in the epigastrium, because the higher you put the trocar, the further you get to the pericycle area, only a few centimeters from the camera port. The ideal is also, four fingers, or it's 5 cm from the from the umbilicus, it is enough. And you push the trocar maximally, to the abdomen, then you get enough distance from the epigastrium trocar to the pericycle area.
Okay, I hope the question is satisfied, Dr. Natalia. You have more question actually. Thank you for the question, but we have a very limited time now. We are next to the last question, Doc. Last question, okay. Coming from Dr. Eric Corputi, asking about selamat pagi Dr. Eric dari Bekasi, mau menanyakan untuk endoloop jika tidak ada benangnya, apakah bisa menggunakan benang cat gut biasa atau benang lain?
Ya, bisa, sangat bisa. Jadi endoloop yang fabricated, yang branded itu memang praktis, sudah jadi, kita tinggal insert lalu ditegangkan, itu akan menjadi loop yang secure. Tetapi bila fasilitas itu tidak ada, kita bisa membuat sendiri endoloop dari benang koromba, dari PDS bisa. Hati-hati kalau monofilamen itu licin, jadi bikin simpulnya yang banyak supaya secure ketika dibuat noti. Tapi sangat bisa membuat endoloop. Bahkan bila tidak menggunakan endoloop, bisa dengan slip knot. Slip knot seperti yang diajarkan di basic suturing teknik workshop itu, jadi knotting dibuat di luar, dimasukkan ke trokar, lalu didorong dengan knot pusher, kemudian membuat loop di dalam diikatkan. Jadi banyak approach sebetulnya. Endoloop yang branded itu enak dan praktis sekali jadi, tapi kalau itu tidak tersedia, bisa membuat sendiri. Apakah dengan endoloop yang dibuat oleh kita sendiri atau dengan slip knot?
Baik, Dr. Erik, mudah-mudahan jawabannya dapat menjawab pertanyaan dokter. Dr. Rudiman, I think we are now at the end of the session. Probably you have a last message for the audience. Please go ahead before we close this webinar.
Okay, I thank you very much for Pak Cepi and the team from the AMC for conducting this nice webinar on Saturday morning. It gives the opportunity for a sharing session. And so I wish you all the best for the AMC team. And for the attendees, I thank you very much for all your participations. Of course, if you have a further question that is cannot be covered here due to time limitation, just feel free to ask me to direct message from my Instagram. I would be happy to answer. And as a take home message for the appendectomy tips and tricks, always safety is number one. And then the second, avoid wound infection at all your costs. And then I hope all the tips and tricks that I share here is beneficial for your current or future practice. Thank you very much, Tepi. Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you.
Okay, great. Dr. Rudiman, thank you for sharing the lecture to us, to the attendees. We just facilitate this webinar together with in line with our educational program. So thank you again, Doc. Before we close, we would like to inform you that we would appreciate if you can fill the feedback form from us. This feedback form will be appear when the GoToWebinar is finished. Your feedback will be much helpful for us in order to improve. As appreciation to your presence, we provide Doctors to Doctors Manual book from Karl Storz. The link for download will be submitted to your email after this webinar. It is about suturing. I hope it is beneficial for you. Again, we thank you, everyone. Special thanks to Dr. Reno Rudiman, who already sharing with us. We appreciate you being here all. Thanks again for joining us today, and we will see you next time. Have a good weekend, everyone. Thank you, Doc.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.